Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Christ Church. So good to see you this morning. Let's stand together and worship. We're going to sing about His grace. Oh, yeah. Oh, You're amazing. Let's sing it out.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings, yeah. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Oh, let's sing it out.
Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, yeah. That You would take my place, that You would bear my cross. Oh, You laid it down. You laid down Your life, that I would be set free. Yeah, yeah. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that You've done for me.
Yeah. Who brings our chaos?
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who's the nation with truth and justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Let's sing it out.
Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, yeah. That You would take my place, that You would bear my cross. Oh, You laid it down. You laid down Your life, that I would be set free. Yeah. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that You've done for me.
Yeah. Anybody thankful? Come on. Sing this.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, yeah. That You would take my place, that You would bear my cross. You laid it down. You laid down Your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that You've done for me.
Sing with you this morning. Y'all sound great. Let's sing this. Highest mountain or lowest valley, Lord, we will choose to praise.
God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. Working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. Let's sing that verse again. I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. Working all things out. Let's lift it up. And yeah, lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. And yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will. And I choose to the name of all names, that nothing can stand against. And I choose the praise, yeah, to glorify, glorify the name of all names, that nothing can stand. Come on, the voices. I choose the praise, lift it up, to glorify, glorify the name of all names.
Singing out, you are here. You are here, moving in our midst.
worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Sing it again, waymaker. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart, Lord. I worship you. Lord, I worship you. Yeah, you are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Oh, you are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. That is who you are.
So much. Please be seated quickly. This is usually a time we would go into communion, but we are not doing communion right here. We always ask you to remember at home, go do this together with your family, by yourself, and give that quiet time to remember how amazing he was by sending his son and what his son did for us. So don't forget communion. Okay, please hear me. Don't forget it, because we're not doing it. Okay, it's for believers. It's for people that understand what Jesus did. So go home at some time today. It doesn't matter. It doesn't make it any better that we do it here. You know what I mean? It's your time with Jesus to say thank you so much. I want to take that body, that wafer that represents, or what, that bread, whatever you use, let it symbolize what it means, that he gave up his flesh for us. He took a beating for us. He went to the cross for us. And then drink that juice and just remember the blood that covers our sins. It gives us that way back home. So we don't have to worry about anything going on in this world. We have a home that is perfect. There's no more fear, no more pain, no more suffering. And you just never know. That's why we always need to be ready. I just want to share a prayer quick, because my wife was supposed to be singing today, and she was off key a little bit, so I told her to go home. No, I'm just kidding. Gosh. Don't tape that. Darn it. I'm just kidding. It's serious. We have seven kids together, and our oldest two, their father passed away today, just now before she got up here. So she went to tell their kids that. So I'm going to pray, because you never know when it's your last. And I know we always have things going on. Hustle and bustle. Things are going rapidly. Sometimes we forget that we're just here a quick blip. All right, so I'm going to pray for that. Remember communion. Don't forget Jesus. That's our whole life. That's everything we need. Nothing else matters. Dear God, I thank you so much for your love. I ask you to lift up my sons right now, that they're a loss for their earthly father, but they have you that will never leave them, and you'll always be there for them. I ask you to just be on my wife and, again, our oldest two right now, and everyone else that has that family has been affected today. Bless them. Help them see you, see the good in you, go to you, pour into you, and love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'm going to sing a new song this morning. Just really helps describe the heart of the Father.
Father again and again and again.
in my chest, your mercy is calling out. Just as I am, you pull me in, and I know I need you now. Run to the Father, I fall into grace, done with the hiding, the reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I run to the Father again and again. I run to the Father, I fall into grace, I'm done with the hiding, the reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I run to the Father again and again and again and again.
Seated. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much. Just give us the words that pierce our heart today. Help us grow. Help us learn. Help us be better and just like your Son. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you guys so much. Just a few announcements before we get going on this Father's Day. One, happy Father's Day to the fathers out there. There is Dad's root beer out there for you to take and drink after service. If it's going long, you can go get some and bring it back in. I'm just kidding. But just a few announcements. Connection card right here. It's in the front of the seat back. If you please haven't filled this out or you have any prayer requests or praise reports, please fill this out. It's the way we stay connected. In this time, I don't know if you've gotten emails. I send emails and texts when things change. Things change rapidly here lately. So just put your legibly, your email, your number on here so we can connect with you. We won't bother you with a lot of stuff. We just want you to stay connected to what's going on here at Christ Church. And again, the prayer request, man, we come together. We want to pray with you. Don't hurt alone. Don't go through things alone. Let us pray with you. We have a team that prays over the request. They're confidential. We don't share them to everyone, but we want to pray with you as a staff. And we will go over those and praise reports as well. In the craziness of life, good things are happening. So let's praise and celebrate that. The next thing is the food drive. It's been awesome. You guys are bringing in food. I know we have two more weeks. This week and next week, we'll be collecting the food, and then Mesa Food Bank will come get it. And they have specifics. So if you have a wonder what to bring, there's a list out at the Welcome Center. You can take that home, bring it next week, so they can pick it up on July 1st or whatever they're picking that up. The next thing is ways to give. We don't talk about it much because you need to get it from God. Ask, seek, and knock. Okay? We give here. We believe in it, but I don't want to feel like I have to force you to do something. You'll get it from God if you seek it. So think about it. We have different ways you can give. You can write a check. You can give online. You can drop in the buckets outside. We don't pass an offering tray or bucket either. Okay, it's a serious time for you to reflect, just like communion, on what God wants us to do and being obedient to Him. So look at those ways. They're all secure. There's no problem with your credit card information being out there or whatever. So do what you have to do and just know that it's all His. And we're here to monitor it and to utilize it in the best we can. So thank you for that. And then the last thing before we get going, July 1st, it's a Wednesday. We are going to have a worship, prayer, firework night. We're going to come here, and it's going to be loud. It's going to be worship music. It's going to be just let it loose and thank God for all He's done. And we're going to have a blast in here. We're going to have baptisms. Hopefully, if you have not been baptized, we will have the baptismal ready to go during the set. We'll go and do some baptisms, and we will have prayer time where you can come up and pray. Just let's celebrate. And we will have fireworks and bomb pops outside after to enjoy that quickly. Don't get too crazy. They're not going to be really high up there and like, whoa, okay, there'll be some fun stuff just to celebrate together. But we're so glad you're here. We're so glad you're connected. Keep shining, keep inviting, and know we love you. Thank you so much.
But sister, they are just niños trying to release their wiggles.
Ignacio, they are wrestling in a sacred place.
Okay, orphans, listen to me. Listen to Ignacio. I know it is fun to wrestle. A nice pile drive to the face, or a punch to the face. But you cannot do it, because it is in the Bible not to wrestle your neighbor.
So you've never wrestled?
Me? No, come on. Don't be crazy. Listen, I know the wrestlers get all the fancy ladies and the clothes and the free creams and lotions. But my life is good. Really good. I get to wake up every morning at 5 a.m. and make some soup. It's the best. I love it. I get to lay in a bed by myself all of my life. It's fantastic. Look, go away. Read some books.
Oh, there it is, friends. I've been waiting for a moment to play some Nacho Libre, but it's just really hard to do that in between songs. You know what I mean? We have this ongoing joke, me, Jordan, and Keith. It's like any well-timed Nacho Libre quote is always on time. So we're having fun. But the title of my message this morning is My Father's Good, Really Good. Oh, man. So I guess Keith thought I was the most qualified since I have the most kids on staff. I have 5 kids, 4 boys and 1 girl, and they're 11 to 17. And I love being a dad. I'm learning and growing up with my kids. Any dads can relate to that? Hey, now. Yep. We grow up with our kids. I'm going to start us off with a really good dad story. So my wife and I, we lived in the Nashville, Tennessee area for a couple years. And we lived in a little town called Woodbury, Tennessee. I called it Mayberry because this was very country living. As a matter of fact, the largest establishment there, commercial establishment, was a Piggly Wiggly. I didn't even know they still had Piggly Wigglies, right? And so we had just had our 5th baby, and all of our kids, we had them all close together. Our oldest wasn't quite 7 when we had our 5th, no twins. So yeah, so we were busy. So my wife, I think our youngest was a couple months old, and my wife was having a night out with her friends, And so I decided, you know what? I'm going to go shopping at the Piggly Wiggly with all the kids. I got this. I'm good. And so I get going, man. I've got the youngest ones in the cart, you know, the little guy in the car seat here on the top, and my daughter, who was the second youngest, she's in the cart, and then my 3 boys, they're just kind of tagging along, getting into stuff, you know how they do. And so we get all done, And the bagger says, "You need help out, sir?" "No, I got this, man. Thank you. So I appreciate it, buddy. Thank you, though." And so I go out, and it was a little bit hilly in Woodbury, and so the parking lot was on a little bit of a slope. Some of you may know where I'm going with this. So the parking lot's on a slope. I'm carting the kids out, and I open up the back of our van, and the slope's going this way. And I just put my foot behind the wheel. I don't know why I didn't empty the 2 young kids out before I decided to empty the groceries out. But I got this, right? I'm a great dad. I can do this. And so anyway, my oldest boys, they start getting into the car, and the back of the van is open, and I'm carrying the groceries out, and my 3rd oldest falls out of the back of the van, and is crying, and as I go to help him, the bottom of the groceries fall out. The bag explodes. We had a big glass jar of honey. It cracks all over the bumper. There's honey all over the place. I got a kid crying. I got two babies here, and I'm trying to keep this thing from going downhill. And all of a sudden, I look down, take a second look. My second oldest is now licking the honey off the bumper. Don't lick the honey. And I look at my oldest son, Eli, go get help. And so I'm like, oh, got all this going on. And the bagger comes out. His eyes are like this big. 15-year-old, like, what is going on? So he helped me get it all together. Nobody died. Nobody rolled down the hill. Everything was great. But we had a story for Mom when we got home. When she got home, let me tell you. But anyway, being a dad is amazing. And we get to talk about God our Father this morning. We get to brag on God a little bit. And I'm really excited about it. Because, you know, anybody that's ever preached or you shared something, you know, it ends up being more for you than anybody. And that's really how this has been for me. So we're not in the red letter series necessarily, because this is a Father's Day specific, but our passage is from the red letters of Jesus. So I'm going to ask if you feel like it this morning, let's stand together, and we're going to read God's word together in the book of Matthew, chapter 11, 25 to 30. At that time, Jesus prayed this prayer, "O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, thank you for hiding these things from those who think themselves wise and clever and for revealing them to the childlike. Yes, Father, it pleased you to do it this way. My Father has entrusted everything to me. No one truly knows the Son except the Father, and no one truly knows the Father except the Son and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him." Then Jesus said, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light." Let's pray. God, thank you for today. Thank you. I think we get to be together, and we get to celebrate who you are. Because, God, we know that the more we know you and your true character and who you're like, the more that affects how we live for you. So, God, we ask for clarity, for your truth, to truly see who you are through your life and through your relationship with your Son in the Gospels. And we just thank you and love you. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 You can be seated. So what's very interesting is that in the verses right before those final verses in that passage we've read, Jesus says the word Father five times, right before he says, "Come to me." So what's obvious, because Jesus turns, he speaks to the Father, first couple verses, he speaks to those who are listening, and then Jesus speaks as if he is the voice of the Father. So Jesus is revealing the heart of the Father to us in verse 28 to 30. And I've never seen this until I studied this, but Jesus actually quotes Exodus 33:14. And Exodus 33:14 says, "The Lord replied to Moses, 'My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest.'" So here's Jesus speaking the words of the God of the Old Testament. This is God in the flesh. He was 100% God, 100% man. I want to look at a couple more key things Jesus said before we officially dive in this morning. I love this. John 10:30, "I and the Father are one." And the word "one" is important because any Jewish listener would understand that, because they prayed the Shema prayer every morning and evening. Every devout Jew would pray that. And for thousands of years they prayed it, and they continue to pray that, which is, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one." So Jesus is speaking something very familiar, and he is explaining his relationship to his Father with what he's saying. In John 14:6-7, Jesus told him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. If you'd really known me, you would know who my Father is, and from now on, you do know him and have seen him." One word for that, boom. That's Jesus dropping the mic, and he does that a lot in the Gospels. Because everything we need to see about the character and the heart of God the Father, we see in and through the life and relationship between Jesus and his Father. And that's what we're going to be looking at on this Father's Day. Anybody excited? Amen. Come on now. We're going to get into this. We're going to have a little, hope you're ready for a little Bible brunch, because we're about to, you're going to see some smoke coming from the computer back there, because we're going to roll through a lot of scriptures this morning and got a lot to say. So I'm not going to try to hold you, dads, you know, on Father's Day, but I'm excited. So we know it's important to know the character of God. It directly affects how we live for God. So we're going to look at this morning the four really good characteristics of a really good father. All right? Number one, a really good father affirms his love for his kids. Let's look at the baptism of Jesus in Mark chapter 1. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my son, whom I love. With you, I am well pleased." Hear that affirmation God the Father has given him? And you know, when you accept God's affirmation in your life, you willingly do whatever he asks and more. Because affirmation is a reciprocal situation in a healthy relationship. It actually goes both ways. So Jesus affirmed his love back to his Father, not only with his words, but with his obedient life. He lived it. He showed it. He showed his love for his Father, and he affirmed his love back to his dad, his father. Any father in here, a father of teenagers especially, will know that the number one way a teenager affirms their love to their dad is making fun of their dad. Right? Dad, you really going to wear that? You know, like, oh, man. I'm going to show you an example of that. Here's a picture of me in the grocery store with my family. Pull up that first photo. You can see the somewhat disgruntled look on my face, and I'll show you why. Go ahead and move to that next photo. Here's what they were doing. They were taking the stickers off the fruit and putting them on my back. And I said, y'all better quit that. The produce manager is going to come out and kick you out of here. But kid, they love to make fun of me. And I have to realize, they love me. this is them loving me. And since it's Father's Day, here's a picture of me and my boys camping a couple weeks ago, my homies. And three of those guys are taller than me. It's crazy. And then here's my girls, my wife and my daughter, and love those faces. Whenever I see your smiling face, right? That's it. That's the family. And just a warning, there probably will be sporadic singing throughout the sermon, just because I can't help it. So if you fall asleep during this sermon, man, you must have pulled an all-nighter, because I'm going to do all I can to keep it moving here. But that's my family, and I feel the affirming love in this reciprocal relationship, and that's how a healthy relationship works. And as I'm affirming love for my kids, hopefully I don't have to force them to love me in return and be obedient, right? Sometimes a little hard, you know, they're working through some emotions, which, okay, what are you feeling right now? What's going on? You know, why don't you want to do this? Let's talk about it. But that's a part of the relationship. But here's what I want you to see this morning, is that God the Father did not force Jesus to suffer and die. Yeah, he drank the cup of wrath that was necessary to pay for our sins. He shed his blood. He took our place. He became the substitute and sacrifice for us on the cross. But the Bible makes it really clear that Jesus did this willingly. And we're going to look at a bunch of verses. We've got them all up on the screen, all in one place, because I want you to see how powerful this is. 1 John 3:16. We know what real love is because Jesus gave up his life for us. John 17:19, Jesus said, "And I give myself as a holy sacrifice for them." Philippians 2, Christ emptied himself and died a criminal's death on the cross. Hebrews 12, because of the joy set before him, he endured the cross. John 10:11, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd sacrifices his life for the sheep. John 10, the Father loves me because I sacrifice my life so I may take it back again. No one can take my life from me. I sacrifice it voluntarily. And then John 15, love each other in the same way I have loved you. There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. So God himself, the God of Israel, came in the form of a man, Jesus of Nazareth, and chose to lay his life down for the world. That's the power of the doctrine of the Trinity and how it all works together. And we're going to go back to the baptism of Jesus because I think it's one of the most beautiful pictures of how the Trinity works together, because you have God the Father speaking affirmation to his Son. You have the Spirit coming down, empowering the Son. And then you have Jesus, the Son of God, completing his messianic task of self-giving love, going out and doing that. So as we think of the Trinity and how this all works out together, we have to be careful that we don't make God the violent one or the mean one of the Trinity, right? Because sometimes we're like, man, I love that Jesus. And man, I love that Holy Spirit. But boy, that God the Father, whoo, look out now. You don't want to get in his way. But that's just not, it's just not true. We're kind of going deep a little bit this morning, but hang with me here, because a lot of these things I have wrestled with, you know, growing up in church, going to Bible college, and I'm finally in the last year and a half of my life beginning to understand where I need to focus with a lot of these bigger questions. And there's a lot of different atonement theories out there. How did Jesus atone or make us right with his sacrificial blood? How did he do that? How did he make us one with the Father? How can the death of a man over 2,000 years ago provide forgiveness for the entire world? That's a really good question, right? It's a huge question. And that may take a lifetime of prayer, studying God's word, and most importantly, experiencing the power of the cross on a daily basis. And, you know, our heads can start spinning when we think about that how question. How did Jesus do that on the cross? And how did the cross all work? And a lot of people stop and they give up right there, right? It's too big. There's no way. I can't figure that out, so forget it. I'm just going to pass that up. But listen, if your wheels are spinning on the how of Jesus, I want you to stop and think about the why. Let's stop and think about the why of Jesus. Why did he suffer and die? Love. Period. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. And if you remove love from the picture, it changes everything and can really paint a dangerous and unbiblical picture of God the Father. God so hated the world that he killed his Son? No! God so loved the world. And it's dangerous when you take love out of that picture. So we've got to be careful that we look at God in the right way. And if you're spinning on the how, stop and focus on the why. And the why answer is, it's love. And it may take a lifetime to understand the how. And I'm fine with that, because that's what growth is. That's what discipleship is. You know, God wouldn't be God if we could figure him out like that. It takes a lifetime of studying. But the good news of the gospel is understanding the why, which is founded on a love so simple that even children can understand it. And Jesus said, unless you have faith like a child, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. It's a simple faith that trusts in his love. So God the Father is loving, he's affirming, and if Jesus of Nazareth, the Son of God, needed the affirmation of his Father to accomplish his mission and purpose, how much more do we need it? Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed, and he continually received affirmation and strength from his dad. So the question is, what are you doing on a daily basis to receive God's affirmation and power in your life? Are you living for God's affirmation, or are you living for the world's affirmation? And I'm preaching to myself, because I am a pro people pleaser. I love that. I want to hear that. Like, tell me I'm doing good. Approve me. And at the end of the day, all of us, at some time during the day, we're alone with God. Whether we're in our closet picking a shirt out, we're in our car driving. In those moments when you can't depend upon the affirmation of someone else, are you stopping and are you thinking about God's love, and are you receiving that affirmation from God the Father? So God affirms his kids. Number two, a really good father keeps his words to his kids. He keeps his word to his kids. He's a promise keeper, a covenant-keeping God, way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. That's who he is. Promise keeper. And all through the Old Testament, the Jews speak of God being a covenant-keeping God. They called themselves the children of Israel because God made a covenant with them and a promise with Abraham back in Genesis 12, where God established them as his special children and chosen people. Let's read about it. Genesis 12. The Lord said to Abram, "Leave your native country, your relatives, and your father's family, and go to the land that I will show you. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you, make you famous, and you will be a blessing to others. I will bless those who bless you, curse those who treat you with contempt. All the families on earth will be blessed through you." And the important thing to see in that is that we're actually included in that. Did you see yourself in there? Did you know you're in the Bible? All the families of the earth will be blessed. God was thinking of us from the very beginning. That's us. So the Old Testament is this Jewish story of God protecting his kids, being a good dad, keeping his covenant. So when you look at the Old Testament, you may ask, well, what about the violence of the Old Testament? And somebody's like, man, he's going big this morning. He's in some big topics. I've actually, since I've been at the church, I've been asked that a couple times. Well, what about the violence of the Old Testament? That's a great question. How can that be loving? All that messiness and all that violence. And really, that's actually a really Western and modern question. It's from a Western mindset, and I can understand why it can be hard to grasp that. You know, I'm Western myself. It looks messy. I don't necessarily like it. You know, the end of Judges, there's a story, I'm like, man, that's 21 and older. Like, man, there's a lot of messy stuff in there. But if you look at it from an Eastern Jewish mindset, it becomes more clear and we can at least begin to understand it. So let's break this down. The Old Testament is a Hebrew story, so it's going to sound very Jewish and very Hebrew in nature. What defined the Jews the most? That they were God's chosen people. So the Jews were proud to tell the stories and sing the songs, which were the Psalms. They sang these songs and told these stories from generation to generation about God protecting them. So the focus for the Jews was not the violence. The focus was the covenant relationship and the promise-keeping nature of God towards his own kids. So if a man knocked on my door, I opened it up and he said, "I'm here to hurt your family." And I'd say, "No, you're not." The Bible says, lay your life down for your wives as Jesus laid your life. I would lay my life down. I don't own a weapon, but I will come in between that man and my family because I'm a dad that wants to protect his wife and kids. And in the Old Testament, God was protecting his kids, and the Jews were proud to talk about it. So if a proud American, any proud Americans in here this morning? All right. If you're telling an American story, the story of America is going to sound American, right? Proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. Right? Yeah, okay. And the rockets regular, the bombs bursting in air. Right? Okay. I'm just saying, I've sung these songs hundreds of times. I sang for 30,000 people at the D-backs game, the national anthem. Talk about like, whoa, I was so nervous. I had to like do some like breathing and pray before they started. Everybody gets quiet and all of a sudden they say your name and they're expecting you to open your mouth. Oh, and then they put my face on the big screen I was looking at like, don't do that. Why are you doing that? Oh, no. But there is nothing like feeling that sense of unity and us singing that, because we're Americans and these are our songs and we're proud. You know, the bombs bursting in air, they were killing people. Those bombs, that's a part of our history too, friends. So when you think about it, that's the way the world builds its empires, you know, with battles and violence and it's messy and every border means battle. There's a border, there was a battle. And guaranteed, these songs, these American songs we sing, are probably not in the top 10 songs of somebody from France, somebody from Africa, somebody from Australia. There are songs. So here's what's so awesome, is that the more you read the Bible, the more you realize that these stories and these songs are not only the Jewish songs and stories, but there are songs and stories through the gift of Jesus. The Old Testament means Old Covenant. New Testament means New Covenant. The entire Bible is about this covenant, this relationship. And we're included in it. Genesis 12. So why did God choose one special people? Why did he do that? One special people to have a covenant relationship with. I look at it this way. And there may be somebody else that can explain this better. But God's narrow and concentrated focus of covenant love with Israel, one family, led to a wide explosion of love, the entire world, every family, through the death and resurrection of the Messiah, the chosen one of Israel. Laser-focused love, laser-focused relationships, so that on the cross, boom, explosion of love to the wide world. The end of the book of Matthew, when Jesus died on the cross, it says there was an earthquake. There was a literal explosion of love that happened. Something big happened when Jesus breathed his last breath on the cross. And the first person, check this out, the very first person to announce that Jesus truly was the Son of God after his death was a Roman guard, a non-Jew. At the foot of the cross, he watched Jesus. He watched him die. He watched it play out. Guaranteed he'd never seen anything like that. Seven things Jesus said on the cross. He said, Father, multiple times. Father, forgive them for the another. Father, he's crying out. Into your hands I commit my spirit. He's hearing him talk to his father. He's hearing him talk to the criminal on the cross. He's hearing him talk to John, take care of my mom. He'd never seen anything like that in his life. And when he died the way he did, he didn't have to break his legs. They'd normally have to break the legs of the criminal so that they couldn't push up on their legs and take a breath. He didn't have to break a bone because Jesus gave up his life willingly. He'd never seen anything like that in his life. And he said, surely, this was the Son of God. God made it for the whole world. And there's a reason Matthew put that in there, very purposeful, because it's the fulfillment of this covenant that it's now for everybody. It's for us. For the whole world. And I love how the Bible historian N.T. Wright, he sums it up this way. He said, it is the story of love, covenant love, faithful love, reconciling love, messianic love. It's the story of the victory of that love because that self-giving love turns out to have a power of a totally different sort from any other power known in the world. That's the power the Roman guard saw. And his entire life and job description was about power. And he recognized and acknowledged, this was God's son. This is a different kind of power. And he experienced it that day. We're going to talk more about this power at the end. But you won't fully understand the Bible if you just read it with American or Western glasses. You have to see it from the Jewish and covenant perspective. Then you'll begin to understand your place within the story. We're invited to be a part of this great narrative that has stood the test of time. And that's why we have the New Testament or New Covenant, which explains how all this comes together through Jesus. See, the writings in the New Testament, that New Testament church, they were figuring it out. They were taking the Old Testament verses and they were pulling all this in and they were helping to describe all these things. Did you know that there's approximately 250 direct quotes of the Old Testament in the New Testament? And if you include partial or indirect quotes, the number bumps up to about 1,000. So the continuity between the Old Testament and New Covenant was extremely important to the New Testament writers and the first century church. So God made a way for us through the lineage of his special people, the Jews, by sending Jesus so we could be included as his special people to be a part of this great story of covenant love. That's worth singing about, friends. Man, I remember an old song that we sang growing up. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. It's our story. It's our song. And that's what we're talking about. So God was being true to his word, faithful to his promise, faithful to his covenant by sending Jesus, the Messiah. So if we want to benefit from this faithfulness, then guess what? We have to have an answering faithfulness, right? It's reciprocal. It goes together. And this covenant relationship is a two-way street, which leads to my third point. Number three, a really good father disciplines his kids. Uh-oh. Here we go. I did a little digging on this one, I think, because I need it the most. So we got some stuff to say here. This is how we grow. This is how we become the image bearers and reflections of God that we're created to be. There's no way around discipline. No way around. If we are supposed, like in Genesis, God said, let us make mankind in our image and our likeness so that we could help rule the world. We can help reflect God to the world. Well, that means we're going to have to become godlike. We're going to have to get godliness, and the only way to do that is through discipline. Proverbs 3:11 says, do not despise the Lord's discipline. So we're going to go back to Jesus' baptism again. What happened immediately after his baptism? He went into the desert and was tempted. He was being disciplined and trained by his Father so he could complete his vocation as Messiah. Jesus didn't need corrective discipline because he lived without sin, but he still needed the training and the experience of going through tests and trials. But what gives God the right to discipline us? What gives him that right? Because he's holy. He's holy. He's above us. There's no one like God. God's off the scale. He's incomparable to any of us in holiness. You read that all through the Old Testament. Holy are you, Lord. What are the angels singing right now at the throne? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. His holiness, there's no one like God. The Hebrew word for holy is kodesh, which means apartness or separateness. There is no one like God. We will never be God. We are simply a reflection of him. So we stand in awe of God and his holiness. In John 17, I love this, Jesus 17:11, he prays to God and he actually addresses him as Holy Father. And then in verse 17, he addresses him as Righteous Father, which is a sign of respect and reverence to his holiness and how God is set apart. So Jesus, he understood this. He trusted his Father. And unless we understand that he's a holy Father, we won't be able to trust him. See, when we sing to him and we acknowledge him as holy, we can actually relax that he is who he says he is. And we can trust our momentary suffering and our discipline. Because the reason he won't let us down, because he's holy and perfect. Earthly fathers are going to let you down. But God the Father will not, because he is perfect. Because he is holy. And God's holiness is our freedom, not our bondage. Freedom, not bondage. Remember from our opening passage when Jesus said, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Holiness is not about God giving us a list of do's and don'ts. It's about his character and his trustworthiness, which is the solid foundation of this relationship. We're on a firm foundation with God because he's holy. Hopefully that encourages us this morning that he is holy and we can trust him. Hebrews 12. And have you forgotten the encouraging words God spoke to you as his children? He said, my child, don't make light of the Lord's discipline Don't give up when he corrects you. For the Lord disciplines those he loves, and he punishes each one he accepts as his child. As you endure this divine discipline, remember that God is treating you as his own children. Who ever heard of a child who's never disciplined by its father? If God doesn't discipline you, as he does all of his children, it means that you are illegitimate and are not really his children at all. Since we respected our earthly fathers who disciplined us, shouldn't we submit even more to the discipline of the Father of our spirits and live forever? For our earthly fathers disciplined us for a few years, doing the best they knew how. But God's discipline is always good for us so that we might share in his holiness. No discipline is enjoyable while it's happening. It's painful. I love this, how real this is. It's so great. But afterward, there will be a peaceful harvest of right living for those who are trained in this way. The goal of God's discipline is to share in his holiness, to be holy as he is holy. What a privilege that we get to share in that. So here's the question. How do we obtain it? How do we really grow? How do we do this? How do we get holiness in our life? Here we go. 1 Peter 1. Prepare your minds for action and exercise self-control. Put all your hope in the gracious salvation that will come to you when Jesus Christ is revealed to the world. So you must live as God's obedient children. Don't slip back into your old ways of living to satisfy your own desires. You didn't know any better then. But now you must be holy in everything you do, just as God who chose you is holy. For the scriptures say, you must be holy because I am holy. Holiness means to be holy God's. W-H-O-L-Y. To be holy God's, completely devoted and committed. And that only happens by applying God's discipline from the inside out. There's a method here. It's from the inside out. I'm going to break this down a little bit. I'm not a philosopher, but as I thought through discipline, I thought of three types of discipline that we all experience. Number one, self-discipline. This is active. It means I am initiating the discipline. Physical fitness, work ethic, studying, daily responsibilities. I tell my kids, please brush your teeth. The world will thank you for brushing your teeth, for learning this, for being responsible and becoming disciplined in this. So self-discipline. Secondly, corrective discipline. It's passive. Someone else is initiating this discipline. It's punishment, consequences, etc. I ran a red light a few years ago. I had to take defensive driving. I experienced corrective discipline from the state of Arizona. Yes, we all experience it. And I got to tell a story about my dad. My mom and dad are watching on Facebook in Texas. Hey, mom and dad, love you. Happy Father's Day, Dad. But just remember, Dad, when your kids make fun of you, it means they love you, right? So when I was learning to drive, my dad, I remember him, I was 15, 16. My dad said, I remember, son, if you're safe, take your time. You don't have to rush anywhere. You take your time, you're safe, you're careful, you won't get any tickets. That's why I haven't gotten a ticket in over 20 years. Wow, Dad, that's awesome. That week he got a speeding ticket. Oh, I love you, Dad. Man, he was driving, I think it was over 5 over in a speed trap, you know, and he's like, what? Broke his record. But everybody experiences, we all experience corrective discipline at some point. And number three, circumstantial discipline. It's passive. Something out of my control is initiating the discipline. It includes pain, sickness, suffering, pandemics, etc. Okay? And God uses all three of these disciplines for our growth, but only if we allow inward change by being Christ-minded. This is the key now, okay? This is the key. Remember 1 Peter 1, it said, so prepare your minds for action. And the mind is a major theme in the New Testament. Man, when you start looking at it and seeing it, you'll see it everywhere, especially for the Apostle Paul. He says it all the time. And why is it such a big deal? Because the mind is our internal software. And it's the guide to our heart and affects every decision we make. The heart and mind are spoken of together so much in the Bible too, because they work in tandem. And this is our internal software. If we don't focus on preparing and renewing our minds, we'll always be convinced that our way is better than God's way. We'll always be convinced of that. And that's exactly what happened in the Garden of Eden, right at the beginning. Check this out. Genesis chapter 3. The serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals the Lord God had made. One day he asked the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden?" "Of course we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden," the woman replied. "It's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we're not allowed to eat. God said you must not eat it or even touch it. If you do, you will die." "Oh, you won't die," the serpent replied to the woman. "God knows that your eyes will be opened as soon as you eat it. You'll be like God, knowing both good and evil." Verse 6, the woman was convinced. Where does that happen? In the mind. She saw that the tree was beautiful. Its fruit looked delicious. She wanted the wisdom it would give her, so she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband who was with her. He ate it too. At that moment, their eyes were open and they suddenly felt shame. There's the heart. Felt shame at their nakedness. The mind and heart work together. So from the very beginning, the beginning of the story of humankind, we see the importance of the mind. So how do we have the right mindset for spiritual growth? What does it really look like to be Christ-minded? Glad you asked. Philippians chapter 2, one of my favorite passages. And this is actually the way it was written in the Bible. It was written as a poem. So Paul is kind of regurgitating, rewriting this common poem about Jesus. Maybe it was a song they sung. Maybe it was a poem that they all recited together. But here it is, Philippians chapter 2. "Have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing, emptied himself," is what some translations say, "by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him." I heard a preacher say once, every time you see "therefore," you need to ask what it's there for. It's important, knowing this truth that we just talked about. Now we can see God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. Therefore, there's another one. "My dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it's God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose." And friends, let me just tell you, God won't work in you if you don't let him into work. God will not work in you if you don't let him in to work. There's a space in my life not too long ago where I took the Bible, and I'm being very real with you. I took it, I set it aside, and I thought, you know what? I'm good. Bible college, grew up in church. I'm okay. I became a name-only Christian. And I began to think, well, you know what? Maybe truth is relative. Maybe I need to find my own truth. And the mind started affecting my heart and affecting my decisions. And my sweet wife said, "Who are you? Because you don't sound like the same guy that I married. What's going on here?" And I committed to her that we would, you know what? I'll pray with you. We'll start opening up the Bible together. And I was a little disgruntled doing it. Very real with you. Because my mind had begun to say, it's okay. You know what? Look at all the good people out there. If I were fine, I'll be fine. I'm just going to float through this life. And that in between, that straddling place became so uncomfortable for me and was affecting my life and my family. And I had to put my nose back in the book. I had to put my nose in the book. And I had to see myself in the book. And I began to read in Genesis where I was included. And read when Jesus said, when I am lifted up on the cross, I'll draw all men unto me. That's me. God's included me in the story. And all of a sudden, my mind began to change. And all these things, these truths that I've heard all my life have begun to just rise up in me. And now I have a reason to sing. I'm not just singing. I'm not just going through. I've sung thousands of times worship services. But I don't have to go through the motions anymore because I am choosing, and it's a daily choice, to let God transform my mind. Because I think my way's the best way if I don't let God come in and show me his way, right? So Christ-minded emptiness and humility that Paul was talking about is how we allow God to work in us. That's how we do it. It's the emptiness. It's the humility. And that's how we can know with assurance that all things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to his purpose. When we are emptying ourselves and humbling ourselves, we can trust a verse like that, and we can say that with confidence because we're trusting God and our mind is being renewed. God can even use a pandemic for my good if I'm willing to empty myself and let him fill me up with his love, with his truth, and work on my heart. So God can use self-discipline, that corrective discipline, circumstantial discipline, all for his purpose if we allow him to work in us, transform us from the inside out by changing the way we think. Here's another one, Romans 12. I think Don hit it last week. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will, his will is, his good, perfect, and pleasing will. Our minds being renewed by God's mercy is how we're transformed. Did you see the therefore at the beginning of that? Therefore, what's it there for? I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy. He says that, in view of this truth. Romans 11, the whole chapter, look at it. It's all about God's mercy. The whole chapter. So Paul's saying, okay, now that we've established this truth, and mercy is not getting what we deserve. Anybody has experienced God's mercy in here? Not getting what you deserve. My goodness. We know his mercy. And so Paul said, therefore, you're standing on a truth that can't be shaken. Because of this unmovable truth, I urge you, offer your bodies as a sacrifice. Don't conform to the pattern, but be transformed by renewing your mind. Philippians, Paul also says this, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection. And we go, woo! And then he says, and share in the fellowship of his suffering. And we say, whoa! Mucho te querisi, right? You know, it goes from woo to whoa real quick because we don't like the suffering part. We don't like the hard work. We don't like the discipline that's required to grow. I don't like it. I really don't. But James says this, James 1, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Man, that's good news. Choosing joy is not a position of naive denial. It's a position of strength and courage and trusting God, and God wants us winning, not whining. And it's really easy to whine when all you hear is bad news over and over and over again. But our Father, our good Heavenly Father, wants us to grow up, be mature and complete, not lacking anything. But that, because that is what a really good, loving Father does for his kids. That's what he does for his kids. It's the discipline. It's the hard work. But that's what's required. That's what a loving God offers to us today. Number four, a really good father provides for his kids. Matthew 7, which of you, if your son asks for bread, will give him a stone, or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give gifts, good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? So in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you. For this sums up the law and the prophets. I think many of us would say, absolutely, God provides for us physically, financially, spiritually. But how do we keep from turning God into a sugar daddy instead of a real daddy? We have to make his kingdom, his mission, his purpose, our greatest pursuit and our greatest treasure in life. You notice how in verse 12, at the end of that passage, Jesus gives the golden rule, do unto others as you would have them do. There's a reason for that. It's because the goal is not about what we receive from the Lord, just getting from the Lord. It's about using those gifts to accomplish his goals and give to the world. Right after he says, your father gives good gifts, now, boom, golden rule, do to others. Give it. You get it, you give. You receive it, you give. Receive it. That's the relationship between us and God the Father, of us receiving from a God who provides for us. Matthew 6. So don't worry about these things, saying, what will we eat, what will we drink, what will we wear? These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers. But your heavenly Father already knows all of your needs. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he'll give you everything you need. Jesus also said this in Matthew 13. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure that a man discovered hidden in a field. In his excitement, he hid it again and sold everything he owned to get enough money to buy the field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant on the lookout for choice pearls. When he discovered a pearl of great value, he sold everything he owned and bought it. Have you found the pearl? Have you found the treasure? This is an all-in mentality. It's all in. My dad told me a story the other day. He said he turned on the radio and heard a preacher say, I've never seen a hearse pulling a U-Haul trailer. You can't take it with you. Can't take it with you. God's treasure has to be our treasure, and we have to be all in. And I'll be honest with you, God has hit me hard. Like I said, I've had a renewal in my heart. I've had a coming back to Jesus in my life. This message of all in, so much so that I wrote a song about it. Hopefully you'll hear by the end of the year. I got an album going. These songs, I can't help it. I got to get these songs out. But this song, All In, I'm all in. I'm living for my friend, the one who rescued me, set me free. I know he's coming back again. I'm all in. Sing my praise to him. Now my shame is gone. I've got a brand new song. I'll never be the same again. I'm all in. All in. I'm all in. I need to sing that for me. If you want to sing that with me someday, awesome. I need to sing these songs for me. I need to make this story my own. I need to say, God, you are my Father, the same yesterday, today, and forever, the same God of the Old Testament who established this beautiful relationship in the story of mankind that God is inviting us. That is why you cannot compare Christianity with other religions. It's not an apples to apples, friend. Christianity is based on a relationship, not a set of rules. There's no other way but all in. How do we go in and why? Because Jesus, God's greatest gift, went all in for us. What did God provide? He provided his son, who went all the way to the cross for you and me so we can experience the love of the Father, be his sons and daughters, be his image bearers, and share this really good, life-changing love and news with the world. What's our response? We don't have a slide for this because this just hit me this morning. So I'm going to read it for you. Romans chapter 2. What is our response to all of this goodness that God's provided? Romans 2:4. Don't you see how wonderfully kind, tolerant, and patient God is with you? Does this mean nothing to you? Can't you see that his kindness is intended to turn you from your sins? That's why we have all the gifts, all the goodness of God is repentance. And God wants to give his kids the power to live the life they're created to live. So God gave us the greatest power of this universe, and it's called self-giving love. And Jesus showed us that the way up is down. The way up is down. And that the power of love overcame the love of power. If you want to get an overall understanding of what the cross is all about, think of it that way. The power of love, self-giving love that Jesus gave, overcame the love of power. How are the kingdoms of this world established? They're established through power. Why do we run to other things in our sin? I have the power. I can play God. Isn't that what Adam and Eve were tempted with? Isn't that what they did? Ooh, maybe I can be God. Maybe I can be just like God. There it is. That's the basis of all sin, and that's the basis of the broken humanity that needs a self-giving love, the power of love. The power of love is greater than the love of power. Where in your life do you need to let the power of love shine through? When you feel that love of power creep up, wait till I respond on this on Facebook. I'm going to give it to him right now. Woo! You feel that love of power well up. Self-giving, emptying, Christ-minded. Let me lay myself down. How can I allow the power of love to be shown in my life rather than this love of power that everybody else runs by? That's what makes us different. That's where the power comes from. And repentance, friends, is the key to the power. Repentance. When I say, God, I need you. And the more we see how good God is, all these characteristics of God the Father, doesn't it make you say, boy, he is so much better than me. Boy, do I need a God like that, because I am not like that. I've got a problem, and I need him. I need his answer in my life. So his death and resurrection proved that the power of love overcame the love of power. The world runs on that power, but Jesus' kingdom runs on the power of love. And here's a couple verses about this power, and we're almost done. This is it. 1 Corinthians 4:20, for the kingdom of God is not just a lot of talk. It is living by God's power. Well, if that's not a verse for today, I don't know what it is. There's a lot of talk, and there always will be. But living by God's power is what makes the difference. We relinquish our pride and the love of power when we let the selfless love of God take over. And that's the power the church was built upon. The early believers, they proclaimed, Jesus is Lord. And let me just tell you, the leaders and rulers of the world of that day, they didn't like that. When they said Jesus is Lord, they were saying Caesar is not Lord. Caesar is not Lord. It's crazy. The first chapter of Philippians, 20 times, Paul says King Jesus, Messiah. He proclaims Jesus as king, and it's almost just a point right in the face of Caesar. And at the end of Philippians, you want to know something really cool? It says those in Caesar's household that know the Lord say hello too, by the way. But the Apostle Paul said, oh, by the way, I'm saving this for last, but I want you to know that Jesus has invaded Caesar's household even. So he's establishing him as king. But you know, when you say Jesus is Lord, you may get killed. But you know what? Every time they killed a Christian in the first and second century, it was like hitting the repeat button on the death of Jesus. Repeat. Self-giving love. The power of love. Over and over and over again. And they couldn't stop it because it's the greatest power in this universe. 2 Peter 1:3, by his divine power, God has given us everything we need for a life, living a godly life. We've received all of this by coming to know him, the one who's called us to himself by means of his marvelous glory and excellence. Ephesians 3, I pray that from his glorious, unlimited resources, all the resources we just talked about this morning, that he will empower you with inner strength throughout his spirit. Then Christ will make his home in your hearts as you trust in him. Your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. May you have the power to understand, as all God's people should. Paul said, hey, everybody should have this power and know this. Know how wide, how long, how high, and how deep his love is. May you experience the love of Christ, though it is too great to fully understand. Then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and power that comes from God. Now all glory to God, who is able through his mighty power at work within us to accomplish infinitely more than we could ever ask or think. That's some power. I haven't even barely tapped into that. This is what's hit me so hard, friends, is that if we believe that the same power that raised Christ from the dead lives in me, then I can today live without sin. If I focus on today, humble myself, allow God to take my mind and my life and tap into that power. So when I acknowledge the power of Jesus' death and his resurrection and I bow my knee to his authority, I allow his blood and his self-giving love to wash me clean. That's when I can enter into this beautiful covenant relationship with a holy, loving God, and then he raises me up in resurrection power. Every day it's a death and a resurrection, and that's the abundant life that Jesus promised. So we can trust him. We can run to him, friends. He's the same yesterday, today, forever. And all Jesus asks from our passage that we first read this morning, with the heart of the Father, Jesus says, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. Because that's what a really good father says to his kids. Amen. Amen. Let's stand this morning. We're going to sing this chorus together. Because life's not right without singing, in my opinion. But we can run to the Father. Oh, thank you, Lord. Yeah. We run to the Father this morning. Run to the Father, a fallen of grace. Done with the hiding, the reason away. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. Run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 yeah. Oh, 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 oh. Lord, thank you that we can run to you, that you are a really, really good Father. We thank you that on this Father's Day, where many of us have not known a great earthly Father, we can trust and we can lean upon the one who will never let us down, that nothing can separate us from this covenant, life-changing love that you give us. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Happy Father's Day. Love you all. We'll see you next week. Grab those masks if you have them. Love you.